We're so used to thinking of gravity as something that pushes us to the ground because it's so simple and obvious. Newton represented gravitation as a force of attraction whose strength depends on the mass of an object. Einstein, in his attempt to explain how gravity worked, showed how it's curvature of space-time, and matter is only traveling along those curves in space. There weren't any forces. So how did Einstein end up disagreeing with Newton, saying gravity isn't a force? Well, first, I need you to think of a box.
If you were Newton, you'd see this box with a little arrow in the center. This is what the box feels as the force of gravity between the Earth and the box. Now start moving it. The contents start moving towards the side, just like when someone jumps off a cliff and starts moving to the bottom of the Earth. Now Einstein said this, there isn't anything behind the box attracting the contents of the box towards this direction. So how come if we compare it to a person jumping off a cliff, you say there's an attraction between the person and the Earth, causing the person to move in this direction?
Newton would say, well, didn't you exert a force on the box to make it move? No different than the force of gravity to make us fall down? That is correct, but let's look more closely, Newton.
Put this person in a box. What happens is that this person experiences the exact same scene as if they were in some random place in the universe, far, far, far from Earth, with no Earth or anything to make it feel any force of gravity. So going back to the cliff with the exact same scene, there shouldn't be any force of gravity on the system. When we look outside where we can see the whole thing, really the Earth is the one accelerating.
Well, what does that even mean? The Earth is accelerating upwards. What would that look like? Dropping things on Earth would make Earth bulge in different directions?
No, it's just another frame of reference for the same thing. It just means that a force of attraction isn't what makes us fall towards Earth. No such force exists. But how can we still consider a force of gravity in physics classes?
On that scale, it's just practical to call it a force of gravity because parts of this system have the same rates at which time passes. But since we're getting specific in this video, gravity is more than just a reason clumsy people shouldn't own fine-tech pens.
But isn't Newton still correct because his equations calculated an acceleration of 9.8 meters per second squared for objects falling near the surface of the Earth?
Yes, his theory is still very much correct, but Einstein's curved spacetime had a larger scope, and this is where it gets really interesting.
Einstein said spacetime gets warped because of how much matter and energy is contained in that area, right?
Pretty hard to imagine space to curve, so let's just take a curved surface that we know very well.
Now put two people on different points on the equator and make them walk in a straight line, the same way objects move through the curves in space-time. Alice sees Bob accelerating towards her, even though they're just moving at the same speeds.
It's the curvature that creates an observed acceleration, that 9.8 meters per second squared. And remember, this is an analogy. The Earth is actually curved space-time, and Bob isn't a person. Bob is the Earth. So that answers the question then. Gravity isn't a force. Thanks for watching, I'll see you next time. If only it were that easy. On a massive scale, it's not a force, but what is a force anyways?
A force is defined by an interaction between particles. This is an interaction, this is an interaction, this is another interaction. So many forms of interactions, but if you cut them all down into the smallest interactions, there's really just four kinds. The strong force that holds protons and neutrons in the nucleus, the weak that makes nuclear fission possible, the electromagnetic that acts on charged particles, and the gravitational that acts on things with mass. John Wheeler, a theoretical physicist, said this, "Space-time grips mass, telling it how to move. Mass grips space-time, telling it how to curve." And the fact that the amount of matter and energy in a given space curves space-time, affecting other matter that may pass by this area, that in itself is an interaction.
And it can't be described by the other fundamental forces, so it must be another on its own. The question is, how?
Now what the other forces have in common is that they all have a massless particle that is essentially the messenger between two pieces of matter. Photons travel back and forth through charges, and that whole process is the force of electromagnetism working. We've detected all the particles except for one. Surprise, surprise, it's the graviton.
So far, I've mentioned two theories, general relativity and a portion of the standard model of physics, a theory of the big and a theory of the small.
We can't just choose one theory and get rid of the other because both theories work. If not, our atoms won't have dense nuclei composed of like charges that are supposed to repel each other. We also won't have radioactive dating and nuclear fusion. The latter powers our sun. You'd also be falling through your chair if it weren't for the repelling charges on the surface of the chair and your butt.
We also wouldn't have GPS.
If the universe didn't have different rates at which time passes, then we wouldn't need to adjust the clocks used in GPS. But doing that throws our location off by kilometers. Because the way GPS works is that the distance is calculated by the time it takes a signal to jump to your phone, multiplied by the speed of those waves. Which is a big-ass number. But if we did apply Einstein's theory and made space-time all curved, remember, a curved surface provides an acceleration to an object. The satellites, being further from Earth, and therefore having space-time less curved, experiences less acceleration. Less acceleration means moving slower relative to Earth. Moving slower means faster clocks.
Knowing Einstein's equations, we can adjust this difference in time to d equals c times t. And there you have it. You get the exact location you are in fact in. So gravity is and isn't a force. Hopefully this has made your world look more fascinating. More confusing, but still more fascinating. We've only scratched the surface, but if you're interested in more science, you know what to do. For real this time, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.